we start, just to give out some house rules first. So for those who are viewing via Zoom, feel free to raise any questions in the comment section, in the chat button below, or in the Q&A button below. And for those who are viewing via Facebook Live, we have a comment section below. Feel free to just write your comments or questions there so that we can try to answer them on air later after the presentation. And only those who have successfully registered and viewed on Zoom will be eligible to get a certificate, and a feedback form will be emailed to you after the session. And the certificate will be emailed within a week. And note that this webinar is recorded and shall be made available later after this webinar. Now, without further ado, I'd like to call on Sir Frank for his presentation. Sir?
I would like to thank the Intramuros administration for inviting me to share with you a subject matter that is closest to my heart, the Colegio de San Juan Letran, which has recently marked its 400th year of existence in the service of God, country, and community. To reduce a quadricentennial history in 50 minutes is not exactly an easy task to do. My presentation will therefore be limited to significant milestones and to very little known facts about the venerable institution. The bare facts are sans explanations as to the whys and wherefores, and will be reserved for the questions and answers portion of this webinar. For those who wish to research further or conduct fact-checking, you'll find all the information, documented sources, notations, biographies, indices, internet, uniform, resource locators, or URL, in my book. Excuse me. Before anything else, I'd just like to inform everyone that this presentation is copyrighted. And all, unless noted otherwise, all the images here are the property of Colegio de San Juan de Letran, who has given its permission to be used in this presentation. As I was mentioning earlier, if you wish to research further, all the facts and references are available in my books, Letran, An Untold History. Volume 2 has not yet been launched because of the existing pandemic, but you will get glimpses of it in this presentation today. Please note that the standard history of Letran has been written by two old rectors of Letran, actually. The first, the first is written by Padre Fray Jose Valdez in 1691, and the second one was written by Padre Fray Evaristo Basaco in 1933. After conducting a thorough research and fact-checking, many of the unsupported statements contained in both books needed to be corrected. I wish also to highlight the historical relationships between Universidad de Santo Tomas and the Colegio de San Juan de Letran. Although intimately intertwined, each institution has its own unique culture and traditions. That is the principal reason why there are two educational systems under the Philippine Dominican Province, the UST system and the Letran system.
Sorry, Sir Frank, we can't see the slide. We're just seeing a white sheet of the white slide with Letran.
Oh.
Tama po.
Are you still seeing it?
We're just looking at a white slide with the word Letran.
Are you seeing it now?
Wala pong share screen now po. It's off.
How about now?
Perfect, perfect.
Okay, yes. Thank you. So as I was saying earlier, this is a copyrighted material and all the, unless otherwise noted, images are property of the Colegio de San Juan de Letran with permission to use granted by them. And these are the two books I mentioned earlier that contains all the facts and references. And only the volume 2 has not yet been launched because of the current pandemic. Now let's begin with the cross, which is the symbol of Letran. You know, as you will see, this cross of Letran is similar to this cross over here. This is the heraldry of Pierre de Aubusson, the Grand Master of the Knights Hospitalier of the island of Rhodes. So many said that the cross of Letran is a Maltese cross. That is not accurate. It is actually a Rhodian cross. And in the Letran cross, it bears the school colors, the blue and the red. This is the source of the color. This is the uniform of Letran colegiales or students. As early as 1640, this was their uniform. As you will see, the mantle they wear is blue colored, and the tippet or the beca is red in color with the cross of St. John affixed to it. That's why we have the blue and red colors. By the way, the red tippet or the beca is an indicator that this particular colegial is a scholar. Non-scholars do not wear the beca. Only scholars are allowed to use the beca. This is our motto, Deus Patria Letran. You know, in my research, I was astounded to find that many of the letters ended with for God and King over and over and over. And so I figured out, this must be where the motto came from. So from God and King to God, country, and they added Letran, the only home the orphans ever knew. Now, what does Letran mean here? It's not only about the school of countless ministers, martyrs of the faith, and heroes, where they lived as a family and as a community. Letran in the motto is therefore a collective representation of family and community. This is the Letran seal with all the preceding elements, the white cross on blue and red field, encircled by the wreath of green laurel, represents the pattern of perfection by which all minds that come to Letran are molded. The white speaks for the purity which must be attained. The blue and red field indicates Letran, the battleground where one's character is tested daily by life's challenges and where ultimately the consummate ideal of the cross is accomplished for the ultimate triumph. There is the wreath of green ever fresh for every victory. Then there is the Letran knight. Being a serving brother of arms of the Hospitalieres, The founder evokes heroic images and tales of the night hospital years in the imagination of students through the ages. As knights of the Spanish military orders, the principal vice-royal patrons of the school mirrored similar traditions of virtue, charity, and duty. In view of all these historical memories, it was therefore not surprising that the knight, with all its symbolisms, naturally became the aspiration of every alumnus. The Letran knight is personified by the knight who goes through the rigid tests to purity of his heart and mind as he progresses. From being a page to a squire, until finally being granted knighthood. As a knight, he is armed with a shield and lance, a purity of heart and mind ready to do battle for his ideals. Now, this is the coat of arms with all the elements put together. At the left side of the figure is the spear, symbolizing courage. At the right side is the torch, symbolizing truth. Two key elements every knight must possess in order to attain a balanced formation. The shield contains the Dominican's black and white cross. In the background, identifying Letran as institution of the order of preachers. At the center of the foreground is the Letran seal. The Colegio's motto, Deus Patria Letran, summarizes Letranite's core values of love of and service to God, country, and school. Now, this is the Arriba Letran battle cry. It consists of a Letranite armed with a lance, astride a stallion whose front hooves are raised up in the air. Arriba means onward to greater heights. In equestrian art, the raised hooves means the rider dies in battle, signifying victory or death. It has since become the trans battle cry in any competitive event. The trans alumni fraternity greet each other, Arriba! In their quest for sustained excellence, they invoke Siempre Arriba. They take pride in their heritage, which they refer to as Dugong Arriba. With all that in mind, let's begin with the presentation proper. San Juan de Letran is the Spanish name of the Basilica of St. John Lateran, the official seat of the Bishop of Rome, and was once the seat of the papacy. There were three schools that were known as Colegio de San Juan de Letran. The first was the Colegio de San Juan de Letran de Mexico, founded by the Franciscans in 1529. The second is the Colegio de San Juan de Letran, Manila, officially founded by the Dominicans in 1620. The third was the Colegio de San Juan de Letran de Guam, founded by the Jesuits in 1669. All three Letrans became important educational institutions in the countries they served. Letran de Mexico was originally founded as an infirmary for children and evolved into providing shelter and education to mestizos who were rejected and abandoned by both their native and Spanish parents. It ascended to prominence until the Mexican Civil Wars ended its existence. The only evidences that attest to its past existence are the street and the transportation terminal which bear its name. Letran de Guam was turned over to the Recollects after the Jesuit expulsion. After the Spanish-American War, Guam became a U.S. naval base and all traces of the Catholic faith was completely removed. The school was eventually renamed to the Richard P. Cleary School after the first naval governor of the island. Letran de Manila, the lone survivor among the three, is our subject for today. This unnamed work of art was made by Italian sculptor Francesco Riccardo Monti, commissioned by Letran in 1952. I call it Education Dispelling Ignorance with a Cup of Knowledge. This figure represents education. This blind figure represents ignorance. And education giving the cup of knowledge to dispel that ignorance. This sculpture was originally installed over the portal of the basic education building. The building has since been demolished and replaced by a multi-story building. The original masterpiece is in storage, and a facsimile is emblazoned at the top of the new building's interior wall for everyone in the campus to see. It serves as a symbol and constant reminder of Letran's educational mission and continuing service to the Philippines, considering that ignorance is a major cause of humanity's problems. A good education is an indisputable remedy to this global dilemma. The name San Juan de Letran first entered the Philippines' awareness in 1543. Among the sea vessels of the failed Ruy Lopez de Villalobos expedition was a carrack named San Juan de Letran. The fleet of Miguel Lopez de Legazpi, which arrived in Filipinas in 1565, included a patash with the same name. The name of the School of Manila orphan boys first appeared in a letter to the King of Spain on the 1st of August, 1626. It continued to reverberate throughout the history of the Philippines and continues to play an important role in the country's journey as a nation. My presentation will be in six parts. The first part is between 1620 to 1689, which involves the founding fathers and their legacies. The next part, 1689 to 1826, involves the period when the school was producing church ministers, missionaries, and martyrs. The third part is 1826 to 1872, when it concerns native secular priests and the formation of a national identity. 1873 to 1920 involves the road to revolution and independence. 1920 to 1970 involves the task of nation building. And finally, 1970 to 2020 describes the Filipinization of Letran. Let's start with the first period. Here, you will see two letters written by Hermano Juan Jeronimo Guerrero. The first is dated 22nd July, 1622, and another one is 1st of August, 1625. This, by the way, were provided by the Archivos de Indias. You can see the marks of the Archivos de Indias, and I'm presenting them with their permission. Now, this particular letter is interesting because he reports to the king that as of that year, many students have already left Letran since 1619 after completing their basic education, and they were ready to work, either as soldiers or as religious. You know what happened in 1619? When Letran students were just leaving the school, Santo Tomas just opened on the same year, accepting its first 12 students. So you can see Letran was ahead of Santo Tomas. And in this letter, he petitioned the king for support of the boys because these are orphans of Spanish soldiers who died during the Dutch Wars. And he's asking for support in compensation for the services their father did for the country, for the king. And the king approved it. Now, this letter over here is the first time he mentions the name of his school. He calls it Seminario de Niños Huérfanos de San Juan de Letran. It also tells him that the first sum of money of support the king has authorized was so small that it is not sufficient to support the children. So he's asking for more. And also in this letter, he mentions his will, and he is bequeathing Letran to the Hermandad de Misericordia or the Third Order of Saint Francis if anything happens to him. Now, these two gentlemen are the royal patrons of Letran. To your left is Felipe IV of the House of Habsburg, the king who gave the initial support and patronage to Letran. To your right is Felipe V of the House of Bourbon. This king, after Letran's subsidy has been given for over a year, granted it for perpetuity. So the amount of subsistence Letran was getting was good for life. And because of that, Letran became a royal college because of the patronage of the king. So from that day on, Letran was known as Real Colegio de San Juan de Letran, or the Royal College of San Juan de Letran. Now, these two gentlemen over here are Letran's vice royal patrons. They are the governor generals. To your left is Juan Niño de Tavora, who is a member of the Spanish military order of Calatrava. He is a knight, a genuine knight. And to your right is Sebastian Hurtado de Corcuera, also a member of another Spanish military order, the Knight of Alcantara. So as you can see, we had a heritage of knighthood since the beginning. Now, Don Niño de Tabora was a very resourceful governor general, because at the time, that's why Letran was only getting such small amounts in support, because the Philippine government at the time was always in deficit. It's always broke. So what he did were really, really brilliant. You know, he would talk to a beneficiary of a benefactor of Letran and tell them, you donate this so much money to Letran so they can build their school building, and I will give you an encomienda. And he has done that. And then he granted Letran a factory that produces rice wine and corn wine, 10 factories of that, so that whatever revenues from that factory will be for the benefit of Letran. So when this governor general died, oh, everybody missed him, you know, until this other fellow came into the picture. He removed all those privileges, by the way, and instead gave Letran a permanent encomienda in Bacnotan with about 700 tributes to support him well and good. And this fellow further donated another piece of land outside the Parian, which will become Letran's home for a period of time when the earthquake destroyed their building. Of all the governors generals, these two were important in Letran's existence. Now, this is the letters of Fray Diego de Santa Maria. In this letter addressed to the king, this is also compliments of Archivos de Indias. This letter informs the king that Hermano Juan has died, and he is asking for confirmation all the concessions given to the school by Hurtado de Corcuera. And this was confirmed by the king, by the way. Since we do not have any portraits of our founders, we have to contend with his signature. It is our only link and only proof that he existed during that time. And here you will see he signs his name, Hermano Juan Jerónimo Guerrero, and then his signature, the rubric. By the way, if you translate his name literally in English, it means Brother John, Sacred Warrior. Now, who is Hermano Juan? From my studies, he appears to be a member of the Knights Hospitallers of St. John of Jerusalem, Rhodes, and Malta. And you know, that means to say he's not a knight, he's a serving brother. Because at that time, you have to prove that you you have a noble blood for four generations before you can become a knight. And I tried to explore if ever there was a guerrero who had a noble lineage, and couldn't find one. So being a knight hospitalier, they have five vows, not the ordinary three vows, but five. There is the obedience, poverty, and chastity, but they have two more. They have the vow to serve the poor and the vow to defend the Catholic faith, being a military order. So we have to keep that in mind. And being a member of the hospitaliers, they were bound by a certain rule of conduct. They followed the Augustinian rule of St. Augustine, which will be part of the trans heritage as well. Now, what's so important about Hermano Juan Jeronimo Guerrero? What is his legacy? Okay. First of all, because of Hermano Juan, a school for orphans was founded. Now, what's so great about that? You know, at that time, orphans belonged to the most the lowest class, social class in Spain. And he would be classified together with the likes of prostitutes, petty and major criminals, gypsies, and conversos, newly converted Christians. This is supposed to be the lowest case class in the Spanish society. And so what Hermano Juan did was founded a school essentially for unwanted boys. Letran was originally a school for unwanted boys. And what does that mean? It means that Letran is an act of mercy. That is very important to know, because this will influence the trans culture for the rest of its existence. And why do I say that? Because there are variants of those acts of mercy through the years and even to the present day. In the 1950s, Letran Rector Angel Blas, OP, declared a policy of accepting rejected or expelled boys. It created a howl, especially among the alumni. What are you trying to do, Father? You're reducing the standards of Letran by accepting these rejected boys. I was present when he was having this discussion with my father, who was complaining. And he only said a simple sentence. He said, "Everybody deserves a second chance." So the school for unwanted boys became the school for second chances. And this has gone on and benefited a lot of people with second chances. One example I can think about is Jose Maria Sison, who was asked to leave Ateneo, but Letran accepted him with open arms and gave him a second chance. And he became the editor of the literary section, and he was able to write such controversial books and articles. Everybody knows him today. And a more recent example is our own basketball team, the one that won the last championship in the NCAA. It consisted of athletes who were not shining in their old schools. No. And they thought their career in sports was over. But Letran gave them a second chance. And when in Letran, they bloomed and they became champions, and all professional teams were after them. That's another example of a school for second chances. Now, more recently, another variant of this has come into reality, and Father Clarence even told me about it. He said, today, Letran has become the home of virtual orphans. What do you mean, Father? We have a good number of overseas Filipino workers who have entrusted their children to the care and education of Letran. Well, I was mind-blowing. It was mind-blowing when the Father Rector told me that. You see, the legacy of Hermano Juan goes on. And that's just the first one. He has a second legacy. What is his second legacy? You know, when he died, some historians said he died and received his Dominican habit in articulo mortis, meaning say at the moment of death. But that's not true because he received his Dominican habit 8 months before he died. So he didn't receive it in articulo mortis. But he executed an event, a deed, in articulo mortis, and that is by ceding Letran to the Dominican order. And, you know, he was too sick. He couldn't even sign it. So a notary public and witnesses were there who read to him the deed, the contents of the deed of cession. And they asked him, is this in accordance to your will? And he probably just nodded or winked. And that was it. It was legal. So what's so important about this deed of cession? This deed of cession was unconditional. When you say, you can do what the Dominicans can do whatever they want with that school. No, it has no restrictions, no special conditions. Why? And what's the significance of that? The significance of that is this. I'll give you the example of Santo Tomas, which is the exact opposite. Santo Tomas is an obra pia. It was created because of the amounts of money given to them for the purpose of funding Spanish boys, legitimate, pure Spanish boys. And it cannot be used for any other purpose. So what does that mean? Santo Tomas only accepted Spanish boys. But that restriction does not apply to Letran. For Letran is not an obra pia, you know, and it has no conditions of such. So by the time his successor took over, Fray Diego, he took advantage of it because he was free to do what he wants with the boys of that school. So remember that. It is an act of mercy and it is not an obra pia. Now, who is this Fray Diego? Fray Diego, the highlights of his stay in Letran was an encounter with St. Martin de Porres. The story goes that a certain merchant from Manila arrived in Lima and met St. Martin and told St. Martin that about this brother, cooperative brother, who's taking care of poor orphan boys and such great charity, with such great charity. He was so moved by it, he wanted to meet this hermano, this fray. So by this bilocation, he was teleported to Manila where he met Fray Diego in the grounds of Letran. And when he returned to Lima, everybody was surprised. He was speaking in the Chinese dialect of the people in Manila, the Chinese in Manila. Can you believe that? So that's precisely why when before St. Martin was canonized, Letran became a center for promoting a devotion to St. Martin and for promoting his sainthood. And when that was done, that work was complete for Letran. Now, this is, again, in the absence of any portrait or photograph, I have here his signature. You have this. This is actually the sign of the cross. And it says, Fray Diego de Santa Maria. And this is the rubric with a tail. So there is such a guy who existed. And this is our link to him. Now, unlike Hermano Juan, we have more information about Fray Diego. because the Dominicans were very good in documenting these things. You know, he was born in 1595 in Caceres, Spain, and he professed in 1626, arrived in Manila in 1632, and he died in Mexico after he retired Manila on the way back to Spain in 1657. He is a Dominican, a member of the first order to be granted as a teaching order, where an order has produced such voluminous wonders of intelligence and academic discoveries, monumental works, the Dominican order. And when he was in Manila, he was assigned to be a porter of the Santo Domingo Convent. And you know, being a porter, you welcome people who come to visit you every day. And the most frequent visitors were the poor children who come to him for alms every day. And when he saw them, he said, why don't I get them together and I will teach them so that they will be educated. And so he asked the permission of the superior of Santo Domingo, and he was allowed to get a certain section there for these poor boys. Now, these poor boys are not all Spaniards, by the way. Hermano Juan's school was pure Spanish orphans. Well, Fray Diego is mixed races. So, what is this? So when Hermano Juan died, Fray Diego inherited it. And the Governor General only agreed to approve the Dominicans taking over Letran is that there was somebody who will take care of them. And since Fray Diego has already established himself as somebody who can organize a children's school, he was tasked to take care of Letran as well. So what is this? He was in a dilemma. What dilemma was this? He had to mix Spanish boys with boys of different races. It is unheard of during that time. During that time, the whites don't mix with the coloreds. The nobles don't mix with orphans. So what happens now? He cannot divide his time to two schools. He had to put them together in just one school so he can supervise them. So the presidente of the Santo Domingo Convent agreed with him and allowed it to happen. Why? Because there are no restrictions in the school imposed by the secession deed. That's the difference between Santo Tomas and Letran. Santo Tomas had restrictions. Letran had none. So legally, he can get all of them together under one roof. And because of that, he had to devise a way to see to it that these different races don't start killing each other, especially boys, you know, when they fight. So what did the Santo Domingo Convent president say? We will impose the rule of Saint Augustine. That's again unheard of to be imposed to children. It is only done to adults because it's too exacting. But that was their only remedy to control the racial division among these boys. And it worked. Now, the rule of St. Augustine is a code of behavior, of treating each other equally, of sharing what you have to the rest, of acknowledging your fault if you did something wrong. It was a process of leveling the field. And so the poor boys can now deal with the richer boys on equal terms. And because of that, the citizens of Manila started sending their boys to Letran. The practice then was that the primary education is taken care of by a tutor, which the parents pay. Now, why should they get to pay a tutor when they can send them to Letran, which is just as good because the Dominicans were handling it? And so it came to pass that Letran became a multiracial school because it had no restrictions and it had a rule to follow, the rule of Saint Augustine. That is the legacy of Fray Diego. He was able to mix people of different social classes and backgrounds and treated equally. And it was astounding. It was the first time anybody thought of it in those days, where it's so prevalent to have such discrimination as to race and social caste. It's unbelievable that he succeeded in doing that. This thing about having no rules for Letran, no restrictions for Letran, will prove to be its greatest value. It will be used by the Dominicans when there is trouble, because they can pass it on to Letran, who is not covered by any restrictions. And that will be the history of Letran since then. Okay, this is the founder's mural. It has been with Letran for so long, but very few people know its meaning. So let me try to explain what this mural means. Up here is heaven for God in our motto, the child Jesus in the hands of Our Lady of the Most Holy Rosary. So this panel is God, the God panel. This panel carries the coat of arms of the King of Spain. So this is the panel of country, which is the king at the time. Now, this right section over here is the Letran panel of Hermano Juan Herrero Guerrero. So you will see here the symbol of the Letran cross, the Rhodian cross with the blue and red colors. Now, these boys are supposed to be all Spanish boys, orphan boys. Now, you will see these three gentlemen, that's St. John the Baptist, St. Joseph, and St. Thomas. Now, what do they have anything to do with the Letran? Well, you see, after Hermano Juan's boys are finished with their primary education, they either become soldiers or religious or continue studying. For those who wish to continue studying, they have a choice of two schools, the Colegio de San Jose or the Colegio de Santo Tomas. That's what it means. This is San Juan de Dios. San Juan Bautista, St. John the Baptist, the patron saint of Letran, the patron saint of Hermano Juan, and the patron saint of the nice hospital years of St. John. Now, this side of the panel, you will see here is the Dominican cross. So this is the panel pertaining to Fray Diego. So originally, these boys were from his school. The school, he named it under San Pedro y San Pablo. So who is this? This is San Pedro, St. Peter. Who is this? San Pablo, St. Paul. And who is this? St. Dominic, because of the Dominican order. So there was a time when there was a confusion between the two schools, no? Because this was a seminario, the Niños Huérfanos of San Pedro y San Pablo. And so when they merged the two, they tried so much to remove the name of Letran. But you know, they couldn't do it because the subsidy of the king is to Letran, not to any other school. So they had to keep the name of Letran. So they tried to compromise, and there was a time when they used both the three saints as the name of the school. Colegio de Niños Huérfanos, the San Pedro, San Pablo, y San Juan de Letran. That's how confusing it was. But, you know, since Letran was established earlier, the people of the city of Manila always referred to it as Letran. And so it came to pass that Letran became his final name. Now you will see in this crowd of boys all kinds of faces, and this one in particular has a crown on his head. That means to say, it came to pass that people of noble birth would come to study in Letran. So there was no longer any distinction of classes, social classes, as far as Letran was concerned. But there's another meaning to this. You know, in the records of Fray Diego, there was a student known as Don Juan de Posaleta, who was supposed to be the crown prince of Calonga. We were wondering where Calonga was. We thought it was some kind of kingdom under the sovereignty of Spain. But we can't figure it out where Calonga is. I found out where Calonga is. Calonga is a kingdom in the island of Sangir, which is part of today's Sulawesi. So this fellow Juan de Posaleta was the crown prince, was an Indonesian crown prince who came to Letran to study. And you might wonder, how did that happen all the way from Indonesia? Well, the reason I know is because it came from a Franciscan journal. The Franciscans were the missionaries of that island. And when the king asked him where his son can get a Catholic education, the Franciscan missionaries told him about the school of Colegio de San Juan de Letran. And so the king sent him there to study. So that explains this mystery of the pupil with a crown on his head. So I hope now you understand what this means as far as the founder's mural is concerned. Now, you might be surprised to find this picture. This is the picture of Bishop Gregorio Luwensau, order of preacher. This person studied in Letran, and when he studied in Letran, it was at a very old age. He had to study in Letran because he had to learn basic Spanish. He became a bishop. Now, you come to wonder, how did he end up in Letran? He was what they call a dohiko, a catechist, assigned to the Franciscan missionaries in China. He was so virtuous, he was good in evangelizing, a good catechist, that he wanted to become a Franciscan priest. But the Franciscans did not accept vocations of other races except Spanish. And at that time, even the Jesuits did not accept vocations outside of the white people. So he told him, you must go to the Dominicans because they will accept you. They have no rules as far as racial differences are concerned. And so he did. And so the first thing he had to do was learn Spanish, and he learned it in Letran when the Letran boys were back at Santo Domingo because the school they were occupying was destroyed by an earthquake. Now, he has a nice story. So after studying his education as a priest, again, that's a controversial mark about his education, which needs a lot of explanation, but I don't have time for that. So he was ordained a priest by the Dominicans and sent back to China to do his missionary work. Now, again, he did such a wonderful job. And what happened was the Chinese emperor expelled all the white missionaries. He was the only one left inside China because nobody knew he was a missionary. He looked like any other Chinese. And so that's how effective he was, how efficient he was. And while all the other missionaries were exiled, he continued his evangelizing work in China and became very successful. And it reached the ears of the Pope. because of his wonderful missionary work, the Pope said, I will make you a bishop. And he said, no, I don't want to be a bishop. Then he asked him again, I want to make you a bishop, and this time it's an order. So he had no choice but to take it. So he became the first Chinese bishop of China, Bishop of Nanjing. We will come back to this venerable personality later on, because he will play an important role in Letran. During that period also, the naval wars with the Dutch happened. And everybody in the city started praying for a victory to Our Lady of the Most Holy Rosary. And lo and behold, three ships against three fleets of Dutch warships won a miraculous victory. And what has happened, that was in 1646. There was a study made whether it was a real miracle or not, and they concluded it was a miracle. And because of that, an annual devotion to Our Lady of Landaval started. And from inception, the boys of Letran attended it from the very beginning. And that tradition is still there in Letran. Up to now, every Letran student and alumni will attend the Landaval devotional procession every year. It has become a tradition of the school. Now, who is this fellow? It says underneath, Criollo Rectors of Letran. What is a Criollo? A Criollo is a Spaniard born outside of Spain, as compared to a Spaniard born in Spain. Now, at that time, Spaniards born outside of Spain are considered second-class Spaniards. So they are not really welcome. They're actually being discriminated. Now, the Criollos in Latin America became known as Americanos. And the Criollos in the Philippines became known as Filipinos. So they were the first social caste that were named Filipino, not because of a national awareness, but because of the usage of the times. Now, you will never find a Criollo rector in Santo Tomas. Well, simply because it's a school for pure, legitimate Spaniards. And he's not exactly pure because he was born outside of Spain. But nevertheless, this Criollo, this is not the Criollo, by the way, but he's just a representation. This Criollo, who was born in Manila, became a rector of Letran in 1657. His name was Andres Gomez de Espejo, OP, the first technically Filipino rector of Letran. And he became rector of Letran for three terms, not necessarily consecutive, but for three terms. Just to show you na he's not good enough for Santo Tomas, but he's good enough for Letran, the school of unwanted boys. Now, two other Criollos became rectors for Letran. One who is a natural de Mexico, a Mexican Criollo. And the third one was a natural de Venezuela, a Venezuelan Criollo. Now, this portrait refers to that Venezuelan Criollo. His name is Bishop Juan de Arechidera, who became rector of Letran, Bishop of Nueva Segovia, and also Governor General of the Philippines. Now, Bishop Arechidera was also responsible in bringing in the devotion to Our Lady of Aranzazu. This is Our Lady of Aranzazu, which has become an annual devotion of all Letranites 9 days for 9 days before Christmas. It has been a tradition, and Letran had always been associated with her. You will see this box. This is a reliquary. It contains the sacred bones of St. Vincent Guillaume de la Paz. So these two images are historical and part of the Letran's tradition. Now, the King of Spain, at this time, Carlos II, wanted natives to become priests, but there was such a strong resistance against developing native vocation. It started long ago in Mexico. Again, that's a long story. You'll just refer to my book for that. But anyway, so the king sent the bishop at that time, who is Felipe Fernandez de Pardo, to open schools, and he is authorizing Santo Tomas and San Jose to accept native boys to become priest seminaries. Now, this Archbishop Felipe Pardo had to write a position, because he called an assembly, a junta, to discuss what will be the position of the religious in Manila, whether they will accept native vocation or not. And of course, they said no. So he had no choice but to write a reply to the king saying that the Indios are not interested in becoming priests and they don't have the capacity for that. And because of this letter, he became an anathema. Why? Because he's racist. Everybody accused him of being a racist. And that is what his reputation is now. Felipe Pardo, racist Dominican bishop. But you know, I was curious. I'm surprised, anything out of the ordinary in Philippine history deserves a second look. And this was an exceptional case. I had to take a second look. What really happened to Bishop Pardo? So I was able to uncover his letters. And from his personal letters, he is actually in favor of giving education to the Indios. And he was telling the King of Spain that even the Indios were better students and more intelligent than the Spanish students. Can you believe that? It was in his letter. And so he had to find a way how to get the Indios into higher learning so they can become priests. So he left in his will a certain sum of money with certain provisions so that native Indios can become priests. He had a lot of suggestions, but all of them were not acceptable to the Dominicans. What the Dominicans found acceptable, by the way, they didn't like because it was contrary to the statutes of Letran and the statutes of Santo Tomas. So what happened? They brought it to court. It's a good thing the will of Bishop Pardo, which I read, it's not the one written by Cummins. No, it's really his handwritten will. He gave authority to the rector of Santo Tomas to change the conditions and the beneficiary into some other alternative which he finds more beneficial. So what is that condition in the will? It made his will unconditional. It was not restricted. And so his will was adjudicated, thinking that the Dominicans will found a Colegio de Indios for a seminary and keep Letran separate from it. But lo and behold, the action of the court, I didn't see the decision of the court, but the actuations after that proved that there was a solution. But before that, I'm going one step ahead. immediately after Bishop Pardo died, that was in 1689. The following year, Letran became an ecclesiastical college. Can you imagine a year later, it became an ecclesiastical college, given certain privileges in all church services? Now you come to wonder, why? Why? There must be something there. I think they were anticipating some changes in the educational system because of the will of Bishop Pardo. And lo and behold, what happened? What was articulated was Santo Tomas is made of two corporate entities. There is the Colegio de Santo Tomas and the Universidad de Santo Tomas. These are two separate corporate personalities. The one affected by the Obra Pia is the Colegio, but not the Universidad. So, the Colegiales of Letran are free to go to the university, not to the college, because the Obra Pia conditions do not apply to the university. So what happened was, Colegiales of Letran would study in Santo Tomas. And so Santo Tomas now becomes a university accepting Colegiales de Santo Tomas Colegio and Colegiales de Letran. So now, Indios in Letran could finally study higher education, ultimately to become a priest because of that action. And again, Letran was used because it had no restrictions, unlike Colegio Santo Tomas. So that is an interesting development. It changed the picture. And because of that, more Indios, more naturales, more people born in the Philippines could now have a university education because of this man. He didn't say they were for priesthood, but it says it will open them to higher education. Okay, then comes this other fellow. After he died, he was replaced by this other Archbishop, Diego Camacho y Avila. Diego Camacho Avila is determined to bring in the native secular priests into the parishes and kick out the religious friars. So by the time he arrived, there were a lot of students who graduated from Santo Tomas who are ready to become priests. And so after finishing ordaining all the other seculars who are mestizos and criollos, he still needed priests. So he started ordaining non-Spanish students. And because of that, finally, the natives became priests. This is a picture of a cura de indio drawn by Juan Lozano and provided by the Biblioteca Nacional de España. So finally, the native indio could have a higher education and can now qualify to become a priest. And now starts the new era of Letran from 1689 to 1826, the period of ministers, missionaries, and martyrs. Now, because now we have native priests, we have here a list of people who became the first Indio priest, one way or the other. The first Indio priest was someone by the name of Bachiller Don Francisco Baluyot. He became a priest in 1697. Now, we don't know from which school he studied. There is no record showing whether he was educated in Santo Tomas or San Jose. But we are sure about these three here below because they are all graduates of Santo Tomas. All of the students of Letran studied in Santo Tomas University. while the students of San Jose studied in San Ignacio. Since the Jesuits were expelled, we have no records whatsoever. But Santo Tomas has records. So these were the first native priests of Santo Tomas who were had to be colegios de Letran, colegiales de Letran, because they are not pure Spaniards. Okay, the first of this is a mestizo sangli. His name was Maestro Don Josef Kengsung de Ocampo. He was the first mestizo de sangli. The second is, by the way, this is the degree holder they have, no? This particular, the secular priests were addressed by his degree and the title Don. This Joseph is a maestro. He has a master's degree. So he's called Maestro Don. The next one is Blas de Santo Rosa. He has a bachelor's degree. That's why he's called Bachiller Don. Blas de Santa Rosa. He was the first Indio cleric, secular priest. And the third one is Bachiller Don Juan Maniago, who became the first Indio secular military and hospital chaplain. All of them, colegiales de Letran. Okay, now that the Letran is open for non-Spanish students, they became a vehicle for missionaries who are not Spaniards. Remember Gregorio Luensau, the first Chinese bishop? Well, at that time, the same thing is happening. The Chinese emperor started expelling white missionaries again. In fact, he started killing them off as martyrs. And so because of this expulsion, they could not conduct missionary work in China. So all of a sudden, they remembered Bishop Lo and said, we must develop Chinese missionaries so they can be effective like Bishop Lo. And so this is the result of that. This is a portrait found in the convento of Santo Tomas de Avila. Santo Tomas de Avila, by the way, is the central archives of the province of the Most Holy Rosary. So this particular portrait is around 1770. It consists of what they perceived to be the martyrs of China. You will notice here, this is Saint Dominic Guzman, the founder of the Dominican Order. And here with the head highest is the Dominican martyr Capillas, the proto-martyr of China. He is the first Dominican martyr of China. And the other five are the martyrs of Fuzhou, the five martyrs of Fuzhou, with two bishops here, Bishop Sons and another bishop. And this is the provincial prior. Now, you will notice two Chinese-looking people at the bottom of the rank. They had to be at the bottom of the rank. They cannot be at the same level as Spaniards. So who are also martyrs? They're holding the symbols of martyrdom, which is a crucifix and the palm leaf. And they have the symbolic halo. Now, who could these guys be? Non-Spaniards who are saintly martyrs. We will get to that. But right now, I will identify who this fellow is. This fellow is one Feng Ximing. His sacerdotal name is Juan Bautista de Santa Maria. He was one of the first Chinese scholars of the king. Over here, you will see at the bottom, he must be a learned man. There's a book. And here, he has a scapular, a Dominican scapular. He looks like a Mandarin. So he is a learned Chinese who is also a martyr. His name is Antonio Yan. We will go back to them because this is a very interesting portrait. This is the one Feng Shiming, but the Fray Feng Shiming, otherwise known as Juan Bautista Fung de Santa Maria. The Dominicans approve scholarships to their Asian missionaries. No. And they ask the king to fund it. But while the king has not approved it, they funded it temporarily. So here was the first Chinese scholar to arrive in the Philippines. There were 8 Chinese scholars. But 3 of them went back to China without finishing their studies, and they became secular priests. But the 5 remaining, all of them became Dominican priests. All of them studied in Letran, and as Colegios de Letran, studied in the University of Santo Tomas. Now, they were already not yet ready, but Bishop Sanz was insisting that they sent this man to China because they needed him. And so Juan Feng Shiming was the first Chinese scholar to be ordained, and he had to go to China immediately. But by the time he reached China, all the 5 Spanish missionaries died, were killed as martyrs, which we now call the martyrs of Fushao. Now, this fellow patiently gathered all their remains, all their relics, got interviews about them, you know, to support their martyrdom for sainthood, and sent them to Rome and to Manila. And while he was there, he was alone. Since all of them were dead, he had to be the only missionary in China. So he was lonely. He worked so hard as a missionary until finally his other classmates arrived to assist him. But by the time they arrived, he was arrested by the Chinese officials, and he was sentenced to exile to a far distant province of China, which he had to walk. And he had to cross and be subjected to so many numerous tribunals, exhausting him. So by the time he reached his destination, he died of exhaustion and fever because of the inclement weather. So technically, he was a martyr. But you know, the story fact was, when he was about to be exiled, he gave his confession to his best friend, the son of Antonio Yan. His name was Pedro Yan, who was his intimate friend as well. So he gave his confession and communion and vice versa. And that was the last time he saw him alive. So when the new apostolic delegate came, he constituted a proceso, which probably is an equivalent to our inquest now, to investigate the circumstances of the death of these martyrs. And Antonio Yan was so enthusiastic to help them get all the proof, thinking that his best friend will be included among the 5 martyrs. And lo and behold, he was left out. His own records were never included and sent to Rome. And so because of that, Antonio Yan was so disheartened and just distanced himself from the Spanish Dominicans. And before you know it, he was excommunicated by Palias. And because of that, he led a schism, separated from his superiors. And they just took over the parishes that were assigned to them and not allowed any Spanish missionary to enter that. It was the first schism acted on by Letran alumni. Oh, there'll be another. Don't worry about that. And so here we have students of Letran, one who could have been a saint and one who is not looked favorably by the Dominicans. And because of that, since he was the son of Antonio Yan, Antonio Yan's case for sainthood was also shelved. Okay, so this is what happened in China. Now, this is another familiar saint who became a saint, a Vietnamese. He is also a scholar of the king. No, he's this time from Vietnam. There were five of them, eight from Vietnam who arrived in Letran to study to become priests. But lo and behold, one by one started dying or were not allowed to return to Vietnam. Only three were allowed. And one of them was St. Vincent, as we all know him to be now. The name you see below is his Vietnamese name. So he goes to Vietnam. He was a very courageous man. He took risks in trying to convert people and take care of the converted people until finally he was arrested and convicted with another Spanish martyr, si San Jacinto. But since a Vietnamese, the court said to be merciful with him because he is a Vietnamese, not to execute him, but to keep him alive. But to that, he replied, "No, I have the same offense as my Spanish friend. I deserve the same penalty." So he was executed with his Spanish companion, and they both became martyrs. Now, I told you that there were three of them who were allowed to go back to Vietnam. The third one, the last one to go, was someone who was allowed, then disallowed. You come to wonder what's wrong, no? He must be a very undisciplined man. So finally, on his third attempt, he was finally allowed to go to Vietnam. And then when he arrived in Vietnam, he felt so free. He decided to write a manifesto about the abuses he underwent with the Spaniards in Manila. This manifesto, which I call the Tonkin Manifesto. So just like the case of China, there are two opposites in Vietnam, a saint and somebody who was angry over the Dominicans. Now, what do you think the Dominicans did? They considered this a failed experiment, a failed social experiment. And what happened? They said they were like that because of negative influences from the students in their school. This is from a Dominican historian, by the way, a Dominican Ferrando, who wrote this. They were like that because of the influence in the school they came from. So he was saying that the influence in Letran was such that they made them rebels and hard to control. Was that the subculture in Letran? I wonder. Okay, so finally, now we get moving with the secular priests. And there are three people who made it possible. Carlos III, Bishop Santa Justa, and Simon de Anda. And they timed it during the Jesuit expulsion. Before that happened, that they were ready to change the parishes, but it was interrupted because of the British invasion. So they had to wait after the British invasion to implement the replacement in the parishes. And so when the time came, Santa Justa arrived ahead of schedule before the king was going to announce the expulsion of the Jesuits and decided to prepare the grounds for the replacements. To make matters simple, they were able to take over the parishes of the Dominicans, the parishes of the Jesuits, and the parishes of the Augustinians. What in one blow? And because of the British invasion, Santa Justa wanted to take over San Jose and convert it into a colegio seminario for Indios. And he asked permission from the king. And the king was so upset that they're making spoils out of San Jose. And he made an order. He said, no, San Jose will continue to be a school for Spaniards. And he knows for a fact that Letran, this is the king speaking, is already catering to Indios and Mestizos de Sangli. So you don't need another school for that. And you already have a conciliar colegio. So use that instead. So he decreed, since there is no San Ignacio, University of San Ignacio was closed down, the colegiales of Santo Tomas and San Jose will for now on be for Spanish boys, purely for Spanish boys. And for Letran and the conciliar, colegio conciliar, will be for Indios and for Sangli Mestizos. By the way, the Colegio Conciliar is the San Carlos Seminary. And so even then, it was already known that Letran was for Indios and for the Mestizo Sangli. Now, this fellow helped Santa Justa in taking over. But by the time he was going to finish his tenure, he changed his mind. He wrote, the king says, we have to return it to the Spanish friars because, he says, that the Filipino clerics were making a shambles of their vocation in the parishes. And so now we have definitely where the students should study. This is the Colegial de Letran. As you can see, it's blue and red tippet and the forever cross of St. John. But look at its features. It is oriental. And this is the uniform of Santo Tomas, green. By the way, the blue mantle of Letran is made of cotton, while the green mantle of Santo Tomas is made of silk, just to show you the class distinction. Santo Tomas was really for the elites. And over here is the Colegial of San Jose, rose-colored mantle. And since it's also for Spanish boys, it was probably also a silk mantle of rose color. Now, I will pause here for a while because there's an interesting story about the Mestizo Sanglis of Letran. So, in 1978, there were two Mestizo de Sanglis who were allowed to become Dominican priests. This is really unusual. They were the first Mestizo de Sanglis who became priests and Dominicans at that. What happened? Because while they were studying in Letran, one in particular, his name is Francisco Mariano de los Santos. He already completed his bachelor's degree and he enrolled for his degree in licentiate degree, which is the equivalent of the master's degree. And he was rejected by the UST's claustro. And because of that, he filed a case against the claustro of UST for rejecting his application. And so when it went to court, the court asked the claustro, what is the reason for his rejection? Because he was an Asiatico. Because he was a Chinese. So it was because of racial issue that he was not accepted to apply to a higher degree. So he continued with his case. And guess what? He won the case. And because he won the case, another Mestizo Sangli classmate of his, by the name of Dionisio Vicente de los Reyes, joined him in the case. So he can also get his licentiate degree. And guess what? They again won the case. This time, Santo Tomas had no excuse but to accept them. And so they got their licentiate degrees, and they became also doctorate degree holders. They were the first mestizo sangli doctors of the Philippines. The first ever. Now, this incident was highlighted by Jesuit historian John Schumacher. According to Schumacher, this is the first event of nationalist student activism in the Philippines. Can you imagine that? Because they defied the authority. They sued the authority because they knew they were right. But personally, I think that it's the first case of student activism for racial equality. So nevertheless, they became Dominican priests and doctors of that, but they were sent as parish priests to the north, not as academics, which requires their kind of knowledge and degrees. But it's a historic moment, and it was a Letran alumnus who found a way for his kind to be recognized and fought for his rights in terms of equality. Now let's start with a different period. This period is 1827 to 1872. It's the awakening of the national identity. By the way, these periods overlap each other, but I specifically use this period because of its significance. What happened in 1827? So I was telling you towards the end of the 18th century, and changed his mind about the Filipino clerics, secular clerics. And so the king ordered that all the parishes be returned to the Spanish friars. But again, Santa Justa stopped it. He issued an acto de obediencia. This is the legal form of obedezco pero no cumplo. It is a power given to them to stop certain laws if they think it does not apply to the colony. The point of Santa Justa is if they immediately replace the native clerics, they will all go broke because that's their source of earning as parish priests. And he can afford to do that. So his compromise was let them end their tenure on their death and then replace them. So he was able to delay the return of the parishes. Now, by the time the Jesuits came, the situation became more critical. The Jesuits got their parishes in Mindanao and displaced the Recollects. And the Recollects were able to get the prime parishes of the seculars in Manila in exchange for the losses of their missions in the south. During all of these developments, something happened in Letran. There was a student demonstration in Letran, the first student demonstration in Philippine history. And it was led by this person we see in front of us, Don Jose Apolonio Burgos. Well, to cut it short, they demonstrated against the Father Rector and disrespected him because of something he did. And there was a riot, by the way, between the friars and the students over this issue. And so there were students, they were placed on home arrest in the cells of San Carlos Seminary. Yeah, they used the cells in San Carlos Seminary while they're studying. That was their penalty. And so the findings was they were guilty, not because of the cause, but because of their treatment of the Father Rector. And so their penalty was public apology to the Father Rector, and that they will never do it again. So what happened? Because of that incident, they allowed this fellow Burgos to transfer from Letran to Santo Tomas. Now you might be wondering, what's going on? You know, Burgos is what they call an ochovon. He's an octoroon, 1/8 non-Spanish and 7/8 Spanish. But you know, even the Pope says, if you're only a cuarterón, which is 3/4 Spanish and 1/4 other blood, you are already considered a Spaniard. But again, in Santo Tomas, they're more stricter about it. You have to be 100% Spaniard to enter Colegio de Santo Tomas. So here is a situation where all of a sudden, Burgos was accepted in Santo Tomas together with some leaders of that student demonstration. So what does that mean? That means that must have been the first case of exception in the history of Santo Tomas to accept a non-pure Spaniard, which is Burgos and his colleagues. You know. So now, Burgos is no longer a colegial de Letran, but a colegial de Santo Tomas. And so, but they never forgot Burgos for that demonstration. So the subsequent student demonstrations were always put, the blame was always put on Burgos, because there was a student demonstration in Santo Tomas that happened years after, and another demonstration made by the secular priests during the transfer of the remains of Simon de Anda. And all in those cases, they were blamed on this fellow Burgos. Now, this is the other development in that period. This is Isabel II. She introduced the reforms, educational reforms in the Philippines. In the primary education, which became the first public school system in this part of the world, and in the secondary education, which transformed the secondary education and wherein Letran became a first-class college of secondary instruction in 1867. Now, what does that mean? First-class college of secondary instruction. That means that if you are that kind of college, you can give degrees, Bachelor of Arts degrees, and you can give titles of expertise, the preteritos, to your students upon completion. And this is what exactly Ateneo did, which is the other first-class college, secondary college. But that didn't happen to Letran. What happened to Letran? The five-year secondary course in Letran became 4 years. And the fifth year, you have to take it in Santo Tomas and all the specialist courses in Santo Tomas. So all your graduation records are in Santo Tomas' book. There were no books of graduates in Letran, by the way. That will happen years after the Spanish rule, by the way. And so why did this situation happen? You see, before the reforms, the government of Spain didn't want Santo Tomas to be involved in secondary education. In fact, they wanted to put all the secondary institutions under one called the Philippine Institute. But somehow, because of these two people, those changed. These two people, this is Carlos de la Torre and Rafael Izquierdo, consecutive governor generals, they belong to a group that toppled the reign of Isabella II. And purportedly, they're supposed to be liberal, moderate liberals. When you say moderate, they're still conservative, although not as conservative as the extremists in conservatives. No. Now, especially this fellow, he was able to reach a compromise with the Dominicans. He said, okay. You will keep the university, but you get out of secondary university. But you know, the problem with the Dominicans is that what will we do with Colegio de Santo Tomas? Because it is the Colegio that owns all their haciendas, who is making money for their scholarships. If you don't function, if Santo Tomas doesn't function, they cannot use the money for scholarships. And so the compromise was, okay, 4 years in Letran and the fifth year in Santo Tomas. Agreed. So Letran went through that transition. Perhaps they were all thinking that it was temporary because at the time Spain's government was being replaced every so often. So they thought the same thing will happen and they will be back to normal after a few years. But it didn't happen that way. What happened was it stayed that way. That's why you have a situation like Mabini, who took his first 3 years with a certain parish priest who was authorized by Letran to teach the first 3 years, went to Letran on his fourth year, and on his fifth year, he went to Santo Tomas. That's how confusing it was before. That's why the dividing line between Letran and Santo Tomas was very, very thin. But that's just to give you an idea. Now, that's not the only area these two influenced that incident. These two influenced also what would happen next. It's the Cavite Mutiny, which were blamed on three Filipino secular priests. Of course, there's Gomez, this is Jacinto, and this is Burgos. They didn't know, they didn't even know what happened. They were not involved whatsoever, but they were made a sacrificial lamb so that the friars will have their way. You know? And so by the time they were executed, there were hardly any parish churches with Filipino secular priests left. And after their death, there were no new Filipino seculars. As far as they can go is to be a coadjutor of the parish, an assistant parish priest. Because of their death, the next step happened. The road to revolution. And the death of the three priests became an inspiration to Jose Rizal to fight for reforms. And he dedicated his second book, El Filibusterismo, to these innocent victims. Now, going back to the educational reforms of 1865, it transformed Letran in 1867 as the first-class college. And many of the future nationalists and heroes would go into Letran's portal. Effectively, Letran became the head of the secondary education in the Philippines because of the Dominicans. So everybody had to take their entrance exams in Letran. That's where Rizal had to go to take his entrance exam to be able to study in Ateneo. Now, there was one distinction about Letran at that time, which very few people know. Letran admitted the first woman, first Filipina, to secondary education. And her name was Natividad Zaragoza de Tuason. She has a very interesting, fascinating story, which you will find in my book. All I'm driving at is Letran again broke the rules. At that time, women were not allowed to take secondary education. But here was this woman who was accepted in Letran under special conditions. She was to stay always in the visitor's room and not allowed to enter inside the school proper. And she was to meet her teachers in that visitor's room and take her lessons. It's a very interesting story, considering at that time women were not allowed to take effectively high school. Okay, so because of all the commotion with the Cavite Mutiny and the Gumbulsa Martyrs, everybody couldn't do anything. No one was allowed even to speak the name of Burgos. And so what they had to do was, they had to do something about it. And so those who could afford to study in Spain organized what was called the propaganda movement. Now, these are the three principal players in La Solidaridad, their organ: Rizal, Marcel del Pilar, and Mariano Ponce. Del Pilar and Ponce are Letran alumni. They don't agree with Rizal sometimes, but the important thing is the two, especially Del Pilar, were leaders of the Filipino communities. That's why when there was an election, Rizal lost in favor of Del Pilar. So the work of the Solidaridad was such that they were fighting for reforms in the Philippines. But nothing happened. And so Rizal wrote his Nolimi Tangere and became a favorite book of Letran students. This is a Letran alumnus, Vicente Martigal, who shared his story of how Letranites read the Nolimi Tangere. He said that they had a physics book that's big enough to cover the Nolimi Tangere. So they will read it with that book covering it, hiding it from the teacher. That's how they read Nolimi Tangere in Letran. And then he shares his story and says, one time when the news about the Katipunan being discovered, they noticed that two of their classmates quietly disappeared. One was Emilio Jacinto, and the other was Flaviano Yenko. They never knew that these two were deeply involved in the Katipunan. And so here's three of the principal players in the Katipunan. You have the Supremo, Andres Bonifacio, Emilio Jacinto, considered the brains of the Katipunan, and Pio Valenzuela, one of the top guns of the secret society. Now, Jacinto and Valenzuela are both Letran alumni, and they were co-editors with producing Kalayaan, the Katipunan news organ. And they have a third helper who is also a Letran alumnus. His name was Faustino Duque, who was the printer of the newspaper. So three Letranites were involved in the Kalayaan. And because of this Kalayaan, only one issue went out. They were able to recruit 30,000 new members for the Katipunan, just to show you the power of the press at the time. And so, while Bonifacio was not winning any victory whatsoever, kept losing to the Spaniards, the opposite was happening elsewhere. In Cavite, they were more victorious over the Spaniards. And these are three of the first people to sound the revolt in Cavite. You have Emilio Aguinaldo, Santiago Alvarez, and Artemio Ricarte. All of them were generals. And they won battles in the initial stages of the revolution. Now, in the history of the revolution, there were 17 Letran alumni who became generals. Now, there was also a different kind of front in the war. There was the religious front, and the Letran alumni also were involved. These three are considered fathers of the Philippine Independent Church. You might be surprised. Apolinario Mabini was involved. He was the brains of the revolution. You should read his works. He's simply brilliant. When you read it, you can really see his brilliance. He was the one who wrote the decrees of Agrippa. He was the one who answered all the accusations of the Archbishop of Salida. All the legal implications involved in this venture, it was Mabini behind all of them. And then Agrippa and Isabella de los Reyes, also Letran alumni, when they couldn't get approval from the Pope to replace the Spanish bishops and parish priests to Filipinos, this fellow in particular, de los Reyes, decided to form the Iglesia Filipina Independiente. And that was only when Gregorio Agrippa joined him and became the Obispo Maximo. Now, there was another guy involved in all of these shenanigans. It's Emilio Aguinaldo. He was involved in trying to Filipinize the Philippine Catholic Church. Now, because of the activities of Agrippa, the church had to rush in changing and establishing reforms in the Catholic Church in the Philippines. The first thing they had to do was bring in Filipino bishops, because there is Agrippa who is adding pressure for it to be done. Otherwise, they'll have more problems in their hands. And so these two were among the first Filipino bishops. They are both Letran alumni. Here you have Bishop Sofronio Hakbang and Bishop Alfredo Versosa. So we have something to thank the Iglesia ni Agrippa. Because of them, they were able to make Filipinos bishop because of their threat, their presence alone. And because of them, they kept alive the nationalist spirit. And what is the consequence of that? The Protestant ministers could not penetrate the Catholic communities in the Philippines. Why? Because of the nationalist fervor, they were afraid that these Protestant ministers were actually agents of the American government who were against Philippine independence. And that's all. Basically two reasons why Protestantism did not spread dramatically in the Philippines, because of the nationalist fervor. Now here's something not many people know. When the Americans came, Letran was converted into a hospital when they were bombarding Manila and the Spaniards were holed in Intramuros. They converted Letran into a hospital and called it Hospital de Heridos de San Juan de Letran, the Hospital for the Wounded of San Juan de Letran. And they used the Salon de Actos Publicos of Letran as their hospital. It occupied a sufficient number of beds. And here is a photo of the surgery room in Letran. Can you imagine that? Letran, in the last days of the Spanish sovereignty, became a hospital. It is their last service to the King of Spain. And so we fell to the Americans, and the Americans started giving us tokens of independent activities, like having our local government elections and governorship elections and the first Philippine National Assembly election. But the bottom line is, the biggest was in 1916, when the 14th legislature was in session. That was the first time the Philippine Senate started operating, and the first time the assembly was converted in the House of Representatives. What's so important about that? In the first Philippine Senate, out of the 23 senators, 9 were Letran alumni. In the House of Representatives, out of 90 representatives, 33 were alumni of Letran. And from that period onwards, we see an unraveling of Letran alumni in government. This is a picture of the fourth legislature. So at the very least, 30% of these people are Letran alumni. And then, of course, during that period, the first four chief justices of the Supreme Court were Letran alumni, starting from Cayetano Arellano all the way to Ramon Avencenia. And finally, in the executive branch, the presidency, for four consecutive positions were occupied by Letran alumni. Of course, prior to the Americans, Emilio Aguinaldo was the first president of the first Philippine Republic. And then the next presidents, Quezon, Osmeña, and Laurel, all Letran alumni became presidents of the Philippines. So, but there's another thing. These are the traditional leaders of the land. There are the non-traditional leaders of the land. And these were the champions of the masses. And they surfaced quite rapidly after the Commonwealth was established, because under the Commonwealth, there's universal suffrage, meaning say everybody will vote. Prior to the Commonwealth, only the moneyed people, educated people could vote. Now, under the Commonwealth, everybody can vote. And so then the masses can have their chance to vote for the people they need. And there were three, you might say, people of the masses. The first one, who called himself the first Filipino socialist, is the founder of the Iglesia, Isabelo de los Reyes. He was the first leader of the first labor union coalition of workers. And then we have here Pedro Abad Santos, the founder of the Socialist Party of the Philippines. He was the older brother of Jose Abad Santos. Sad to say, Jose Abad Santos is an American stooge, while his older brother was a nationalist. And against their social status, their social class, he went down to the level of the masses to support them in their quest for justice. And here to our far right is the founder of the Communist Party of the Philippines, Jose Maria Sison, who is also an Letran alumnus. You know, towards the end, when we were approaching, just before the Japanese War, oh, by the way, that period of all of those successful alumni was what was referred to as Letran's golden age. Can you imagine? All the most powerful people in the Philippines were all Letranites. In fact, there was a book I read in Pampanga that everybody wants to study in Letran, because if they study in Letran or Santo Tomas, they can easily get a job in government. Now, the problem after that celebration in Hua, the Spanish-speaking Filipinos were being overshadowed by the English-speaking Filipinos, because English became the dominant language. And that's where Letran was lagging behind. So they had to ask the help of their sister province in the States, the province of St. Joseph, for help to send in English teachers. And so they did send six of their brightest to teach English in Letran. Not many people know this. So before the war, this was known as the Dominican Block. It was a beautiful block, so nice, so elegant. This is where Letran was. This is Santa Catalina. This number two is the Santo Domingo Convent. The number one is Santo Domingo Church. This is Santo Tomas. This is Santa Rosa. And this is the Plaza Santo Tomas. Now, when the Japanese came in December of 1941, the first places they bombarded was Intramuros, can you believe it? And unfortunately, the ones that were hitly direct were Santo Domingo and Santa Catalina and part of Letran. This is what how it looked after the bombing. You see Santo Domingo obliterated and Santa Catalina is all grounded. And here is Letran. Its eastern facade is still intact, but its northern facade was hit badly. But Letran continued to operate during the Japanese, under these circumstances. They had to clean. This is already cleaned up, by the way. It was worse before the cleanup. And so Letran was converted into a bomb shelter. You see these corridors? They covered it with sandbag and they became bomb shelters. And they shared the building with the Japanese. It's a garrison of Japanese Air Force pilots. And they had to share rooms with them. Now, during the Japanese occupations, all the grade schools were allowed to open. And there were only two private high schools that were allowed to be open. One is Letran, the other one was La Salle. But the thing, what's happening in the education of the Philippines, when Laurel became president, the national language became Tagalog for the first time. And Spanish was removed as national language. English was allowed on a temporary basis until everybody could discuss and communicate in Tagalog. The nice thing about the Japanese occupation is they rekindled nationalism once again, which has completely been erased by America. Everybody thinks he was an American, a brown American in the Pacific. So the Japanese jolted back the memory of our forefathers and their nationalist aspirations. So when the Americans were coming back, this time the Japanese told everybody to get out. Why? Because Letran was converted into a base of anti-aircraft artillery and a battery of mortars. It was in Letran that those mortar shells were being menacingly sent around the suburbs of Manila. So that's precisely why it's not only a garrison, it was a base, a bomber base. And so when the Americans came, this is what the Americans did to Letran. They really hit it with all the shells they could, but Letran still stood standing with all its pockmarks of bombshells, still undaunted. But the nice thing about the war is when peacetime came, it opened it up to women. And so for the first time, female teachers were accepted in Letran. And these two ladies in 1950 were the first two teachers, Luminosa Cura and Raimunda Perlas. Now, Mrs. Cura had four sons, all of them Letran alumni. By the way, I'll just make the presentation longer. You can probably ask us. This is the first graduates of pre-med in Letran, of the class of 1956. So as you can see, the war has opened Letran to women. These are the first administrators of Letran. Dr. Generosa Noguera was the first dean of women, a student of Father Blas, and Lucita Villegas, who was the first woman high school principal and vice president for academic affairs of Bataan. And of course, the late Angelita de los Reyes, the first woman basic education principal. But before I go to this period, it was during the term of Director Father Blas that a new policy was introduced. He was going to accept Letran. Letran was going to accept those people who are expelled or rejected by the schools. That's why the School of Second Chances. That was the era in the 50s onwards. Now, to give you a background of the 70s, I'll have to go through this a little back in history. This is Ludwig Teisling, the 77th Master General of the Order of Preachers, whose term was 1916 to 1925. He was the first Dominican Master General to travel and visit all the Dominican houses around the world. In his visit to the Philippines, particularly the Santa Catalina, the sisters, Filipina sisters of Santa Catalina, petitioned the Master General to make them regular choir nuns, choir sisters. Because for years, until then, they were all treated like legas, cooperator sisters. So Master Teisling granted them that privilege. So for the first time, Filipina legas became regular choir sisters. Now, somebody asked me when I told him that, wow, they're lucky. Santa Catalina is lucky. They were able to get a promotion. Why didn't the Filipino Dominicans of Letran ask the Master General? He was there. I had to tell him, sadly, there were no Filipino Dominican priests in Letran at that time. No Filipinos whatsoever to ask for that privilege. Okay, it was not until the 79th Master General by the name of Martin Gillier. He visited Letran in 1937. And at that time, there were already encyclicals from the popes about the development of native vocation. He was an energetic Master General, and he wanted things done and done right away. So when he visited Letran in 1937, he must have given his peace of mind to the Spanish Dominicans, because after that, he began to show he meant business. Among the things he did was that the Spanish Dominicans at that time had three vicariates in Tonkin, North Vietnam. He removed two vicariates, gave one to the German Dominicans and the other to the American Dominicans of St. Joseph. That was a big blow to the Spanish Dominicans to lose two vicariates. But the biggest blow was the vicariates in St. Louis, Louisiana, where they were sending the Spanish Dominicans as novitiates. This particular Master General told them to surrender that vicariate to the Americans. So all of a sudden, the Spanish Dominicans didn't have a seminary for their Spanish novices. So they got the message. So from then on, they built a new seminary in Hong Kong for Asian vocations. And so in 1941, the first Filipino Dominican was ordained. His name was Benito Vargas. So as you can see, if you want things to be done, you have to ask the Master General who can make things happen. And so it came to pass when there is a master who comes to visit, to make his canonical visit, everybody starts speculating what the next change will be. And so Now with the seminary in Hong Kong, Letran finally received its first three Filipino Dominicans, Augusto Antonio, Antonio Piñon, and Gregorio Mundo, Raymundo. Father Antonio was the first alumnus Dominican. There's a story about it. He could have been the first Filipino Dominican, by the way, but he didn't want it. He didn't want the pressure of being the first Filipino Dominican. This was confided in me by another close Dominican who told him about his apprehensions. So he would rather be just one of the seconds. Now, something happened in 1957. Let's go back to these guys before I show that picture again. Something happened in 1957. Benito Vargas and five other Filipino religious wrote a memorial to the Vatican urging greater recognition of Filipino leadership in the Philippine Church. At the same time, lamenting the general death of Filipino religious among the different orders. Who are the six? Hilario Lim, a Jesuit, Ambrosio Manalikod, the Wide Word Seminary, Society of Divine Word, Salvador Calzado, a Recollect, Antonio Garin, as an Augustinian, Julio Ovial, a Franciscan, and the sixth was Dominican, our dear Benito Vargas, the first Filipino Dominican. So what has happened? They brought up the case. There were only 160 priests for more than 18 million Catholics. Foreign religious versus the 1,511 foreign religious versus 163 Filipino religious. Slowness with which Filipinos were being given positions of leadership. So what happened? All of these six were castigated for what they did by their foreign superiors. The other five left their orders, but our brother Benito was faithful to his vows. He continued, even he was sent to the missions in the Babuyanes. By the way, before in Letran, when they say, I'll send you to the Babuyanes, you must have done something really bad. That was 1957. In 1957, this man wearing the plate, we are the man from old Letran, Jose Maria Sison, graduated high school. He must have seen the injustices being inflicted on Filipinos by foreign nationals. And so he started writing his revolutionary ideas. And at that time, there were other controversial issues involving the Rizal course law, the history book of Teodoro Agoncillo, all banned by the church, controlled by the foreign religious. All Catholic universities were completely in the hands of foreign religions. And so, in 1958, there was a visitor, the visit by the Irish Master General of the Dominican Order, Michael Brown. Michael Brown, in 1957, talked to Benito Vargas about his situation and what he thought. And so, this Master General must have given, again, the Spanish Dominicans a piece of his mind. So out of nowhere, nobody expected, Letran received its first Filipino rector in 19, 1961. His name was Isidoro Katikbak, the first Filipino to occupy a high position in a Dominican college. But, you know, after Master General Brown finished his term, Father Katikbak's terms also ended, and the next rector after that was a Spanish rector. So during the time, student activism became prevalent. And so in 1970, Letran for the first time participated in this rally in Plaza Loton, now Liwasang Bonifacio. This was the first time an official delegation of Letran alumni and students attended this rally. It is one of those rallies in the first quarter storm, led by the Central Board of Students chairman at the time, Manuel Peña. And by 1969, another visiting Master General came, which would result in the new Philippine province. But nobody knew that at that time. This was in 1969. So what happened in 1970? So there were already secret negotiations going on with the Spanish and province and the Filipino leaders of the Dominicans. Nobody knew that. Everybody was surprised when this message came out, issued by the last Spanish rector of Letran, Eladio Neria, announcing his resignation and giving to a Filipino rector. At the time, it was Antonio Posadas. And in preparation of a turnover of the school to Filipinos. This was done during the 350th centennial anniversary of Letran. It was a modest celebration because of all the student demonstrations going on. But this is a historic document. And it was timed during the celebration because it meant a lot to a lot of students that finally the Filipinos will take over. This was the radical newspaper of Letran at the time because they closed the Letran News, which I was the editor at the time. And they allowed a student publication not using the word Letran. And so the name Kamao came out, judging that it was a radical newspaper for students. Kamao meaning the fist, which has become the sign in our wars in the NCAA. So finally, the new Philippine province was inaugurated in December 8, 1971. Up in the podium is the new prior provincial, a Letranite, Father Rogelio Alarcon. And you will see all the Dominicans bowing in prostrate on the ground before their new superior. This is called a viña, the Dominican viña. It is their symbol of submission to their superior. That was what was done during the installation. Now, the new province, four provincials were Letran alumni. You have Father Alarcon. You have Father Arceo, who is now the rector of Santo Tomas Legazpi. Father Edmond Nantes, who is now the superior. Sorry? How many more minutes? And Father Rivero was once UST rector, I think. And these are the alumni rectors of LAN, Father Alarcon, Father Pompeo de Mesa, who is the first Filipino alumnus rector, and our present rector, Father Clarence Marquez, all Letran alumni. And then we have our rector builders of Letran, Father Ramon Cercado and Father Edwin Lau. you know, when the Filipinos took over, they were not trained to be able to administer colleges and organizations like that. No. So in the beginning, progress was slow. And at the time, the first college of the province was Letran Calamba. And a lot of Letran Manila's resources were channeled to Letran Calamba. So Letran Manila suffered because of the financial constraints. But when these two took over, at first, Father Cercado was the rector and Father Edwin Lang was the treasurer. They solved the financial problem. Did you know that Letran was able to construct Calamba without borrowing a single cent? That's how they, how hard it was for them. But anyway, these two streamlined the operation and it was smooth after that. And now they had enough money to start building for Letran. And so they built the St. Thomas building. They built the Albertus Magnus building. And they built Letran Bataan. They also built the dormitory of St. Vincent Lim del Paz. They were both from Iloilo. They are Ilonggol Dominicans who knew how to handle money, as all Ilonggos from Iloilo are known to be. And then, of course, after that, the Philippine system, the Dominican educational system was divided into the Santo Tomas system and the Letran system. And the four Letrans became part of the Letran system with Manila, Calamba, Bataan, in Manawag. Of course, the coordination among the four is still ongoing. No, it's going to be a long process. Okay. And so how do you assess if Letran has made good or not? As always, our criteria is our motto: service to God, service to country, and service to the community. So I will show you pictures of people who symbolize the service to those three ideals. So service to God, we have Archbishop Socrates Villegas, an alumnus, and Bishop Teodoro Bacani. They are the persons up front representing service to God. But of course, all Letranites do service to God. Here's an example. Here are old alumni attending the Lanaval procession annually, and their devotion to Our Lady of the Holy Rosary of Lanaval and Our Lady of Aransas, who continues ceaselessly. Then we have people who serve the country. We have three good examples: the Senate President Soto, the retired Supreme Court Justice Chief Diosdado Peralta, and our Executive Secretary Salvador Medialdea, to show you that the men from Letran are still out there in support of the country, serving the country. And we have alumni who are supporting the government programs. And here we have an alumnus, several alumnus actually, headed by Robert Joseph, supporting the Save Manila Bay campaign to clean up Manila. This is how Letranites support the government. No, not only in serving it, but in good projects like this. And of course, the third is service to Letran or to the community. Here we have typical examples. Here is a rice project given for free by a Letran alumnus and his batchmates. This is Mr. Henry Limbongyong, the president of the Chinese Federation of Chamber of Commerce and Industries, a very, very powerful and influential group. But he spends his time to serve the community. Here is the latest, the Mesa ni San Martin. A lot of alumni contributed to supply this outreach. And it is a typical outreach of Letran every year. This is a mission. We have lots of outreach program, a service to the community. That is how Letranites and Letran is being adjudged. Now, I'd like to end this presentation by reading to you a speech that was broadcasted by a Letran alumnus in 1937 over the radio on the celebration of Dia de Letran. In short, his message was, to say Letran is to say the Philippines. Let me read to you portions of his speech because it provides a very good ending to this presentation. So he said this live on Radio KZRM on 30 October 1939. And he says, if you would permit me to put a name or title to this radio program, which is part of the festivities celebrated on Letran Day, I will entitle it The Voice of Letran. However, since to say Letran is to say the Philippines, the title can readily be changed to The Voice of the Philippines. Yes, this program can very well be called The Voice of the Philippines, since this phrase more or less fits the hubris of the moment when we presently allude to an institution whose multicentenary lifetime we refer to was founded, interlaced, and amalgamated with all the most distinguished and outstanding epochs of Philippine history. When we allude to a center of learning and culture, which in the course of centuries was able to transmit its strength, its spirit, and its soul to an entire people, being born with it, growing up with it, suffering and enjoying with it the already painful and glorious vicissitudes of its life as a nation. But I say, parodying the poet, that Letran is not only of the Filipinos and of the Philippines, but is the Philippines itself, with equal essence of the heart, the mind, or the arms of a body that forms its total harmony and beauty, since not one of these members can separate itself from the whole at the cost of mutilating or deforming it. If the history of a people is no more than a succession of deeds and of men that in the course of time and of space contribute to the formation and to the progressive development of a community, bound by the same ethnic and cultural ties, founded in a soul love to the common fatherland, united in the adoration of the land that gives them life, joy, and happiness. It is well to affirm that there exists no single chapter in the history of the Philippines, not even a single page, where you will not find the name or the spirit of Letran. And that, my friends, is why Letran is a Philippine national treasure. Thank you.
Thank you for that, Sir Frank, for that very inspiring presentation. Letran has a very long history, being more than 400 years now. It is quite helpful that you have periodized the long history into six parts. So it's quite helpful. And thank you for sharing as well earlier more information about Guerrero, because as founder, we also celebrate his legacy in this webinar. And it's amazing to see that the early beginnings of Letran, and how shocking it must have been that even in the early years, the races mixed together in Letran, and it goes to show that Letran, even in its beginnings, was already a paragon of diversity, inclusivity, and racial tolerance. And of course, we also had the Criollo rectors, which was quite inspiring. And diversity is indeed an inherent part of the heritage of Letran. And this value is consistent in its four centuries, as seen in Natividad Zaragoza, a notable contribution again of the school, a contribution as well toward women empowerment, and another significant contribution, as we have learned from your presentation, is the contribution of Letran towards the development of nationalism in the Philippines, albeit not directly, of course. We can see that it was the alumni of Letran who led the drive toward independence. And even in the 60s, this was still evident because Letran, once again, pioneered, this time, the Filipinization of education in the Philippines with the installation of the first Filipino rector in 1961, Father Isidoro Katigbag. Indeed, Letran is a school of firsts, and it is a very, its history is an inspiration to us all. Now, to start our question and answer for a portion of this webinar. By the way, everyone is free to ask any questions for our speaker. We can maybe meet 20 minutes more. Is it okay, Sir Frank?
That's fine.
Yeah. So maybe to start the Q&A part, just to ask, what sparked your interest in the study of the history of Letran? I mean, you have two volumes of books, and it's quite inspiring that you have built this literature on the history of Letran. Now, what sparked you in your research in Letran?
Well, you see, I'm a fourth generation Letran alumnus. My great-grandfather, my grandfather, my father were all Letran alumni. And I always listened to their stories about their days in Letran. And then when I went to school in Letran, you know, I've read the standard history books of Letran, and I found so many gaps, so many ambiguities that I decided to start collecting trivia, anything about Letran trivia as part of it. And so, but the real push was when the celebration of the 400th centenary came, our class decided as a class project to have a video of the school's history for 400 years. And they asked me to do the video because I did the class video. But, you know, after compiling all the information, I said, I don't have material for a video. I have material for a book. So that's precisely why I said, I'm going to write a book. And the more deeper I got into it, I was amazed at the amount of information that just kept coming through the internet. I thought it was going to be hard because they're all in old, obscure libraries, you know, and archives. But the internet gave me access to all of this. It started when I requested the Arquivos de Indias for a copy of the Guerrero letter. And I thought I had to pay for whatever facsimile, shipment and all. And they told me, no, you can access it through the internet. I struck a gold mine. And they told me how to go about it. So I went through it and I was amazed at the amount of information you can get. All you need is, of course, to know Spanish and to have the patience to go through all each page. And I loved it. I was being transported during those times. And somehow, you know, information come to me. And I said, am I fantasizing this thing? So as information comes to me, I verify and I find out how accurate it was, that there was supporting evidence for that information. So I was really amazed, you know. It was a very satisfying experience, if you ask me. That's the reason why I wrote it. And I don't think anybody would be interested to write a history of Letran so extensively unless he is an alumnus himself.
Yes. Speaking of your book, sir, several of our viewers are asking, where can we avail of the copies of your book?
Okay. Volume 2 is not yet available. As I said, its launch has been delayed because of the pandemic. But the Volume 1 is available in all the Letran campuses. It's available in the Rizal Library of Ateneo. It's available in the National Library, but the National Library is in disarray right now. But anyway, or you can purchase it from Letran alumni. You can purchase it from La Solidaridad or from this other bookshop, I forget the name. No. But you can go to my website, go to liongson.com, and the information is there. You can also buy it from Amazon, but preferably you buy the local edition because it's cheaper. The thing about Amazon is that the transportation cost, the courier cost is more expensive than the book. That's it. That's how available it is. No, but you know, I didn't intend to have to publish many copies because the market I targeted were really libraries, archives, and the alumni. Not even the old alumni, but the alumni who are interested about Letran, you know, to investigate the depth of Letran, as I have discovered. No, it's more. Letran is deeper than what other people perceive. No, people think Letran is an elitist school. They're wrong. It has never been an elitist school. It has always been a populist school. No, we never had a so-called bourgeois in our time. Everybody was treated equally. Nobody knew who was rich or poor. You know, we all had uniforms. Nobody could tell the difference. But you go to an elitist school now, boy, you will know by the clothes and brand names they wear, the cars they drive, that this is a school for the rich. But not in Letran. It's an egalitarian culture, you know. And we love it. The students love Letran. We have fun in that school. It's a family, let's put it that way. Letran is not just a school, it's a family.
Thank you for that. Follow-up question lang po, sir. Armin Sartre is asking, is it also available in Amazon, Kindle, or is it available online as well?
I have not yet made it an ebook. It's still a hard copy. It was really intended for the quadricentennial celebration as a collector's item. That was what it meant to be. You know, Philippine books, only a few copies are printed. That's why, as a collector's item, they sell at a more exorbitant rate. That's how the Philippine book market is. You buy, let's say, a Teodoro Gonzalo book in the internet, you have to pay at least, what, $500 for a Teodoro Gonzalo book? Can you believe that? And the ones active in the trade, in the secondhand trade, are Philippine history books. Why? Because there are very few. And not generally circulated. I'm lucky I live in Australia. Why? Because I have access to all the libraries of Australia, all the collection, Filipiniana collection of Australia, I have access to under the interlibrary system of Australia. I couldn't do that in the Philippines. That's the advantage of that system in Australia. Yeah. So in terms of research, I had all the support.
Thank you for that, sir. We have several comments in our Q&A and chat box button. We have, for example, Aris Gutierrez, who said that I studied in Letran for 4 years, but these were not taught to us. So what discussed was not taught to the students. We were just made aware that the school was established in 1637, but there was no comprehensive discussion of the rich history. So this lecture by Sir Frank is, we hope, to be a contribution towards the spreading.
I hope so. That's why I entitled my book Letran, The Unknown History, Untold History, because it's untold.
Yes. And then we have from Violeta Munoz, thanking Mr. Francisco Liongson for the very informative and interesting lecture on Letran, whose history is so intertwined with our Philippine history. We can appreciate Philippine history by learning about Letran's history. By the way, one of your alumni, Dr. Still Alicio, AB Spanish magna cum laude, who now teaches in University of San Diego, California. Yes, siempre arriba Letran. And we have from Father Ricardo Macalino said, I commend Francisco Liongson IV for his very informative and touching learning sessions. Now, sir, there are only two schools in the country that whose age have exceeded 400 years. We have UST and we have Letran. Now, Letran has survived disasters, earthquakes, fires, wars, and famine. Now, to what can you attribute its longevity? And what can other schools learn from this length? From how can, like, how do you think Letran managed to survive that long?
I would say it's not the building, it's not the teachers, no. It's the all the people within the school. As I said, we live there like a family. So that's the biggest factor, no? And as a family, we stick together. And we pass this on to the next generation. And of course, you know, the Dominicans have a big thing, a great contribution to keep them there. You know, they don't give up. They go through a lot of hardships, but they stay on regardless of what the conflicts are. Many of these conflicts, it's because of a clashing cultures. You know? We cannot blame people's behavior in the past with our standards today. That's unfair. No, because they have totally different standards during the time. During the time, that was the normal thing to do for them. But now, with Black Lives Matter, that's horrible. You know, they will tolerate that kind of a behavior. But as I said, that was the normal thing to do before. So we can't blame them for that. You have to judge them by the standards of that time.
Were there any traditions or rituals or ceremonies that was distinctly Letran during the colonial era? And if so, did any of these traditions exist until today?
They're so natural. I can say that they're unique to Letran. No? But definitely, like La Naval is a tradition. All Letranites expect to go through all that process. Every Letranite is expected to have his rosary in his pocket and his handkerchief on his other pocket. You know, a Letranite is expected to know his rosary and use it regularly. These are the things that bind us together. Every Letranite will fight from the heart. That's why we have all Filipino champions against imports in the sports arena. You know, against all odds, it's because of the heart. You know, it comes from the heart. It's not something that's imposed, really. It's a family. I think that's what people feel when they're in Letran. You are part of a family.
Thank you for that. How would you describe the contributions of Letran in the sciences during the colonial era?
Colonial era, what years?
Before the war.
Sorry, before the war?
Yes.
Which war? World War?
Second World War. Yes.
In terms of sciences, you know, Letran is known for doctors, lots of doctors. During my time, we had a lot of physicists, we had anthropologists, but you know, since the schools today are geared more to business, there are very few who go into these fields, and normally people are not aware of them. No, but we have many. Like I know a very good anthropologist, Dr. Jesus Peralta. He's a national scientist. No, I know the Bola brothers, they're physicists, but mostly doctors. Mostly doctors. I'll tell you this. No, when Santo Tomas started offering medicine and law for the first time, they had a problem. Nobody was enrolling. No, why? Because they don't know how to make money out of being a lawyer or a doctor. So very few enrolled. That's why it took a lot of time, centuries, before they were able to establish a law and medical chair. You know, the Pope has granted them many times, but they never produce on the deadline. That's why they keep getting approvals until they were able to set up a chair for good. You know? And that happened after the educational reforms. They were forced to get people to study law and medicine. That's why most of the graduates of that time were lawyers and doctors, medical titular. Not all are doctors. Only those who went to Spain became doctors, by the way, because they couldn't get their doctorate in the Philippines.
Thank you, sir. We have a comment from Clifford Danilat. Salamat, Sir Frank, for all your research work. I am a Louisian, but had a chance to visit Father's Convent in Letran years ago. After listening to your webinar, I now appreciate the school and what it stands for. Salamat po. Yes, sir.
But I have a lot of alumni friends who are already proud of Letran, but after reading the book, they're even prouder than before, you know, because they didn't know all those things that happened in Letran.
Sir, for those who are interested in learning more about Letran, or for those who would like to further deepen the discussion, does Letran have an archives of its own that they can visit?
Well, it's not open to the public. You'll have to ask the rector about that. I'm one of the few who was able to access it, you know. Mm-hmm. But that's a matter the rector can decide on. What I would like to have is access to the Santo Tomas archives, particularly the Dominican archives in Spain. That would be good.
Thank you for that, sir. Now, a lot of historical references refer to Letran as the Real Colegio de San Juan de Letran. Now, curiously, they have not kept it at present, unlike UST, which kept it as the Royal University of Santo Tomas. What do you think? Was Letran before truly a royal university? And if so, why did they not keep it now? I mean the title.
Okay. The reason for the royal is because it was under the patronage of the king, perpetual patronage. Now, after the sovereignty of the king ended, the patronage ended, and we had no right to keep the title. Now, UST, the royal title is ad honorem. You know what I mean? It's an honorary title. It's not actual royal patronage. In fact, when the King of Spain granted that honorary title, it had a specific condition that there was no financial assistance involved. You know, so it was an honorary title. Unlike Letran, it was a financial relationship. No? And so once the financial relationship ended, there was no legal reason to use royal, unless for PR purposes. No?
Thank you for that, sir. Now we have a question from Kaiser Banta. So what do you think are the current challenges of Letran in the modern times?
I think what Letran is facing is what all schools face today. There's nothing special about that. Let me put it this way. Letran was unique because there were very few schools at the time. No. Now there are schools everywhere. So you don't have a concentration of good students in certain schools because they have socialized schools and it's accessible anywhere. No? So all the schools face the same kind of problems. The only difference is the culture of each school and their mission and their objectives. That's where the difference lies. No? But they read the same books. They take the same subjects. They're all standardized by the government. No? So the only difference are there are schools are more stringent in their acceptance policies. No? What do I mean by that? That they have to have this kind of grades, that they have to have this kind of income, that kind of thing. No? That's what happens to some elite schools. No? Okay. There are schools who have certain acceptance standards that just limit students who are already diamonds in the rough. All they need to do is be polished and shined for them to come out. No? That's no challenge. That's just polishing. That's not education. Now, for me, the real school, and there are many of them, are those who get the student who are raw like coal and then shape them in the laboratories of education and transform them into gems. Now, that's a school. They convert a humble coal into a diamond rather than a rough diamond and polish them. No challenge in that. And I think that's one of the things Letran does. That's why it's a school of second chances. We always try to give people a second chance.
Thank you, sir. And actually, we have still have a lot of questions, but unfortunately, we are running out of time. Now, to close our open forum, one last question for you, sir. For you, sir, what are the qualities and virtues of an outstanding Letran alumnus?
It's very simple. He who is faithful to the motto, God, country, and Letran, the community. It's very simple. That's why our awards committee just judges your behavior and your achievement based on those three factors. And if you did well in all three, you're an outstanding alumnus.
Thank you, sir. And everybody, that ends our webinar. But before we close this session, I'd like to promote our social media channels. Intramuros Administration is available in Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube. And for those who missed this episode, do not worry, because we are going to upload this in YouTube. But take note, of course, of the copyright restrictions as explained earlier by our speaker. Now, sir, as you have mentioned, you also have a website. Would you like to promote, sir, your website?
The website is just to give information about my books, for people to, if they're interested, where to find them and where to buy them. That's all. It's a simple website. There's nothing fancy about it. But
thank you so much.
If they have questions, they can always email me. My email is there in the website.
Okay, sir. So we're going to post the link to the website in the caption of the recording. So abangan na lang po. And of course, the IA also has a page in Google Arts and Culture. We have digitized a lot of our museum artifacts and a lot of our archival material. So feel free to visit our page at the Google Arts and Culture. And then just to announce that Intramuros is once again nominated as Asia's leading tourist attraction for this year, 2021. So help us win again, because last year we won this award. So we're hoping to win again this year. So help us by voting. So go to worldtravelawards.com, register and vote. Now, to promote our next webinar next week on June 24 at 3 p.m., we're going to discuss with Richard Tuason Sanchez Bautista the architectural character of the five colonial religious orders in the Philippines as observed. So the title of his webinar is Estilong Praile. And on June 26th at 3 p.m., we're going to have Prince Wico, who is also an alumnus of Letran. So his talk is about a digital reconstruction of pre-war Intramuros, entitled Pamanahon. So we have a lot of webinars in the future, and we are going to keep on continuing with our webinar series, the Intramuros Learning Sessions. So abangan, marami pong susunod. Now, thank you so much, Sir Frank. Now, before I finally close this Zoom app, do you have any final words, Paul, that you'd like to say to our audience?
No, I'd just like to thank all of you for coming to listen to me. I hope whatever it is I shared is helpful, and for you to understand deeper, not only Letran history, but the history of the Philippines. As I concluded, if you say Letran, you actually say the Philippines, because whatever happened Letran affected the Philippines. Like, for example, if you read the history of Letran in terms of education, that was what happened in the Philippines. The Philippine education at that time was like that, And it is a matter of knowing who we are. It's part of the process, knowing who we are as a people. And I thank you for coming, and I hope you have learned something from it. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that, Sir Frank, for that very interesting and illuminating presentation. And thank you everyone for those who attended. And we look forward to seeing you again in our succeeding webinars here at the Intramuros Administration. Thank you po, and thank you to Father Rector, Kael Saletran. We hope to have more webinars with you in the future. And yun po, salamat po ulit. And mabuhay, until next time.
Thank you.
Johnny, oh, Johnny, oh, Johnny, oh, 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 Johnny.